Yeah, so I'm Laura and I'm a PhD candidate at Aarhus University, and I will be talking about an assemblage of carved stones from Neolithic Bornholm, and this talk will be based around some of the points and the significant findings of a paper that is so far in preparation that I'm working with along with a few colleagues down here, and one of them is in this room and that's Nils in the back, so I just wanted to make sure that I remember to say that. But to set the scene a little bit, this assemblage all stems from the site of Vasagård in the island of Bornholm, and it is Vasagård is a causewayed enclosure site, and these ditches of the stones, or the majority of them, stem from the ditches of this causewayed enclosure, though there are a few from a nearby timber circle, and this is important because that has been used to date one of the stones. And it's assumed all the stones are contemporary, so right now it looks like the stones date to circa 2900 Cal BC. And the assemblage itself consists of more than 400 small tablets of shale and sandstone and water-rolled pebbles. And these tablets, they vary quite a bit in terms of carving, quality, choice of carving, size, and also material. But as you can also see in this figure, hopefully, there's still some quite recognizable patterns so that we can sort of start to make out some similarities between the stones. And because of this, previous approaches to the assemblage focused on trying to distinguish some main trends and some main types of stones. And this is actually what has given the stones their colloquial name. They're called sunstones because of this example, or this is an example of the so-called sunstone. And the name, of course, derives from this central circle with some radiating, or various radiating lines, sometimes with additional ornaments. So this is like the first type of engraved stone that was recognized from the site. And then more recently, this is a different key specimen that has been, an example of it, that recognized at the site, and this is called a field stone because of these semicircles up here. They have been likened to a plant, and then a plant with a stalk, and then based on this, the grid-like system has been suggested or interpreted as field systems. So this is called a field stone. However, we quickly run into problems when we try to make out a few key types of stone, because Often, for example, we have this plant motif. Sometimes this plant motif is incorporated into other motifs, and sometimes only some constituent parts are present. So then, do we still call it a field stone if we only have some of the semicircles? And should this count as a sunstone because we have the circle? So then we quickly get into troubles as how do we tackle this material? And the way that we tackle this in our paper is that we deconstruct these motifs into various carving elements that so this gives us the ability to look into how they are combined and what structure sort of underlies the combinations on the stones. And we did this by looking through the assemblage various times and drawing out every new element we could see. And then we went through several rounds of reapplication and testing the categories and also collecting them together. And we ended up with three main categories. We have the ones, straight incised lines. Then we have category two, which is various types of circles. And then we have category three, that is various types of semicircles. And then we have a number of subcategories. And this gets us, starts to get us into what can we see, what patterning is evident in terms of the way these carvings are applied. And we were able to see quickly that the straight incised lines, they dominate. They're the most commonly applied ornamentation. And then we have the various circles and the semicircles that are roughly equally applied. And this is perhaps not so surprising because the straight lines, they form part of both the field motif and the sun motif, but it's still quite significant that the straight lines, they are clearly preferred. And then to sort of uncover some of the underlying structure, governing the way these are combined together on the stones, we have conducted network analysis in R. So essentially, network analysis mathematically calculates the relationships between entities and then visualizes it in graphs. And this is a graph made up of nodes and edges, and this figure over here, the ornamentation elements, they're the nodes, so these dots that are dotted around here, and the edges, the lines between, they visualize the relationships or the co-appearance on stones between the ornamentation elements. And we were able to distinguish four communities in this figure over here. We have a community of circles and semicircles up in this corner, and down here, this community is dominated by open letter design and feather-like designs, where we have some of the most commonly applied line carvings acting as bridges between the communities. Then we have some outliers here that are quite different. And then when we plotted the ornamentation elements or carving elements against the stones, we get this figure over here. And so now the stones are the nodes, and the co-appearance are the edges. And this detects similar enough in clusters, but we also get some quite distinguishable clusters here. So we start to see that there are some patterns governing in what is taking place in the ornamentation. It's not just random choice of what carving goes on what stone. Yes. And there's actually also structures as to what carvings goes on what material and so on. However, I cut that out for time reasons. Yes. We can see when we look at this assemblage, and we can also show statistically, that there are structures as to how these stones are produced. But we can still recognize that there is also quite a degree of freedom present in the way that these ornaments are applied to the stones. So how do we explain that? How are these carvings produced and who produces them? And we have tried to tackle these questions from a cultural transmission perspective, where we are discussing, so is this evident of imitation, emulation, or active teaching? And we are currently also looking into more models as to how we can prove some of this. But so far we have, so some of this quite clear patterns in this small-ish repertoire of motifs could indicate some sort of supervision or guiding taking place in terms of the production of the stones. So perhaps it indicates that there was an active tutor guide, or perhaps even also the artist or craftsperson's own normative behavior sort of governed the way the stones were produced. But at the same time, elsewhere, active teaching and other experiments with active teaching that often produces very faithful transmission. So if these stones were produced sort of in a supervised environment, perhaps it was more hands-off supervision, or perhaps experimentation was allowed or even encouraged. And this leads us into how the stones used, so what are they signaling about the society that's producing the stones? Because we have this quite interesting dichotomy between the normativity and the creativity involved in the production. And so we have discussed various analogies, and the one we are sort of gravitating towards right now is Yenhotta's calabashes. So these decorated calabashes that still, they submit to societally sanctioned norms, but they also, then these decorations are then applied more freely and used as a mode or a medium of silent discourse between the community members. And so perhaps these carved stones have similar aspects of like personal individualization, while still utilizing the societally sanctioned norms. And this is something that we'll probably discuss a bit further in the future work with the stones. And we're actually hoping to take it even further. We're hoping to try to get to the bottom of some of the mechanisms lying behind the choice of carvings. Why are some of the carvings and combinations more prevalent than others? So why are the stones produced like this? And so this preference for some carvings or combinations could, of course, there could be some symbolism linked to the combinations and the motifs. This is perhaps quite a classical archaeological interpretation, but we also suspect that there might maybe other biases governing the mutation combinations and preferences. We think it's quite likely that some of these motifs and carvings are more salient and memorable for the human mind than others. And importantly, this would actually be testable in a modern lab, where it could be investigated if simply some of these elements, if humans are better at remembering and better at reproducing some of these elements than others, and if various ways of disseminating the motifs actually affect the way they are transmitted and the way they are reproduced. But that's sort of taking it into some of the future questions that we are hoping to look into. And then I am going to sum up a little bit because I think it's quite a bit to wrap one's head around. So we have the assemblage of more than 400 carved stones from Vasagård, where the choice of material, the shape, size and combination of carving elements structures their production. We can see that most carvings consist of combinations of incised lines. This is followed by various circles and semicircles that are applied roughly equally. And importantly, some carvings and combinations are preferentially chosen. It's not just random. And this, the structure that's lying behind these choices seems to be a several level of normativity, or perhaps rather guidelines that's controlling the manufacturing of the stones. But within this, there's still significant scope for experimentation and artistic license or creativity. And that's all I have.